Welcome to worship with the community of the Broad Street Presbyterian Church. My name is Ann Palmerton, and I serve as one of the pastors. You can learn more about this community of faith through our Facebook page or by going to the website. We're glad you're worshiping with us. Today, our gospel lectionary reading comes from Matthew chapter 21. Jesus tells a simple parable and offers us a choice. I'm calling the sermon, A New Now. Jim and Valerie Hildreth provide music. Chelsea Hart Melcher and Paul Melcher provide the beautiful hymn, Fairest Lord Jesus. And Bill Boggs and his family sing One Voice. During children's time, Dan Gerken and the kids lead us in singing Jesus Loves Me. There is something for everyone in this worship service. Friends, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us worship God.
For today's prayer of confession, I'm going to use a new notebook that I have. It's had some special qualities that will be helpful to us today. And I'm going to write down in this notebook, some things I want to let go of, because that's what confession is. It's identifying those things that separate us from God and separate us from one another. Things we want to let go of, behaviors we want to stop. So I'm going to write down a few of those. Being quick to judge others. That's something I want to let go of. Thinking the worst of people who believe differently than I do. That's a lot to write down. I'm just going to put down thinking the worst. Cynicism. That's something I want to let go of. Not listening well. Not paying attention. Not paying attention to others, not paying attention to the pain of the world. Blaming others. That's something else I want to let go of. There are other things I could write down in this notebook. And there are other things I know that you want to let go of. Behaviors that you long to end. Things you want to stop doing. So I invite you now to name one of those things, either out loud or silently. Name it and mentally add it to this list. So now I'm going to show you a special quality of this notebook. I've got a cloth here. I just dipped it in some water, and now I'm gonna take this list and I'm just gonna erase it. I don't know if you can see this, but this notebook now is, there's no writing on it. It's kind of like magic. And I really think God's forgiveness, God's grace, it's kind of like magic. It's powerful. It's life-changing. It's world-changing. As we embrace God's forgiveness, we have the opportunity to experience a new beginning, a fresh start, a blank page. So friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Alleluia. Amen. This morning, we share forgiveness and we share peace. The peace of Christ be with you this day and always. Amen.
God welcomes all strangers and friends. God's love is strong and it never ends. God welcomes all strangers and friends. God's love is strong and it never ends.
Good morning and welcome to Children's Time. This morning in worship, we're talking a lot about who Jesus is. And we know who Jesus is from the Bible. And often when I think of who Jesus is, I think of the cross or the Christmas story or the miracles or how Jesus healed or how Jesus was friends with people who are unlikely to be his friend or how Jesus loves us. So I was thinking about the song, Jesus Loves Me. It's one of my favorite songs. It's simple, but it contains such an important message. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves you. We've been doing bedtime prayers on Sunday nights with the children of the church on Zoom. And during this time, we play a game, we show our pajamas off, we read a Bible story together, and we check in about how our weeks are going, and we say a prayer together, and we sing. And so recently we sang, Jesus Loves Me. And that tells us a lot about who Jesus is. And I'm going to share the singing of the children with you all right now. Now, all the kids were on mute because Zoom doesn't really work if we're all unmuted. But Dan Gerken played guitar and sang with us, and you can see their little mouths moving as we sang Jesus Loves Me. Enjoy.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me, the Bible tells me so.
A reading from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 21. When Jesus entered the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him as he was teaching and said, "By what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority?" Jesus said to them, "I will ask you one question. If you tell me the answer, then I will also tell you by what authority I do these things. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or is it of human origin?" And they argued with one another. "If we say from heaven, he will say to us, 'Why then did you not believe him?' But if we say of human origin, we are afraid of the crowd, for all regard John as a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We do not know." And he said to them, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I do these things."
What do you think? A man had two sons. He went to the first and said, "Son, go and work in the vineyard today." He answered, "I will not." But later he changed his mind and went. The father went to the second and said the same, and he answered, "I go, sir." But he did not. "Which of the two did the will of the father?" they said. "The first." Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you, tax collectors and prostitutes are going into the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him. And even after you saw it, you did not change your minds and believe him."
This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
It's been a challenging week with the virus, the vaccine, the economy, and politics. Many of us feel vulnerable and shaken. We like to think we are in control of our lives, even though we know we're not. And these days, in the midst of so much change, we feel so out of control. And even though these fall days are lovely, many of you have told me you dread what's coming. Longer nights, darker mornings, being inside, still distant from one another, and often feeling cut off from ourselves. Back when the pandemic first began, I wrote about experiencing what many have called coronavirus brain, when part of our brain seems permanently distracted with everything that's going on. Well, that's starting up again. Yesterday morning, I almost poured orange juice on my morning cereal. We're overwhelmed with change. Adapting is hard. It would be nice to feel like we were more in control. In today's gospel reading, Jesus confronts the people who are in control, or at least they think they are. The day before in the temple, he made quite an impression on religious leaders when he drove out those selling and buying, when he overturned the tables of the money changers. Now it's the morning after, and Jesus returns. A crowd gathers to hear him preach. He's popular. Who exactly is in control is up for grabs. What if on a Sunday morning, a stranger were to suddenly hack into our video presentation and announce that he'll be interrupting my sermon with his own preaching and that it will be better than anything I can do? What if he says that the Broad Street congregation is starving to hear God's word preached to them, and since I'm not doing it effectively, he needs to step in? When I imagine that unnerving scenario, I can understand why the chief priests and elders find Jesus offensive. He interferes. He meddles. No wonder they want him to leave. They ask, "Who do you think you are? What are you doing here? Who ordained you to this ministry?" That's when Jesus challenges them to a kind of theological duel. He asks a question about John the Baptist, about his authority to baptize and preach. Was John an agent of God's mission or not? What follows is one of the great smackdowns in the Bible. The leaders can't claim John as an agent of God because they didn't follow him. But they can't condemn him either because he's popular with the crowds. They realize they're trapped. The only answer they can give is, "We don't know." Suddenly, they've lost the imagined control they never had. It's a pivotal moment. Jesus delivers a stark message. Well-intentioned people can miss God's activity in the world. The questions raised in the temple that day continue to be questions for us in the midst of all that is going on around us. What are we not seeing? What are we resisting that is of God in our time and place? Jesus keeps pushing. He tells them a deceptively simple parable about two sons. It's a short story about who will go and work in the family vineyard. The first son says no. He's direct and clear. But later, he changes his mind and goes. The second son says he'll go, but he doesn't. It's that simple. We don't know what motivates the first son's clear no, but what we do know is that he changes his mind. The first son embodies newness, this idea that a turnaround is possible. We're always being invited to join in God's vineyard work. Jesus delivers this parable to people who doubt that God can do anything new, who act as if God's work is all past tense, who dismiss the Spirit's power to renew. Jesus offers religious leaders an opportunity, a chance to change their minds. They agree that the first son does the will of the Father, and I imagine a twinkle in Jesus' eye. It's a poignant moment, because he grounds all he does in the law of love. Love God, love neighbor, love self. Which means he even loves religious professionals who are stuck in their ways, who hang on to what they think they can control, even when they can't. He tells them they're not left out of the kingdom. They just won't get to lead the way in as they've imagined. He invites them to expand their vision of who's welcome. Even the tax collectors and prostitutes who at first said no to God changed their minds and accepted John's message. They'll lead the way because a willingness to change is always more useful than maintaining an illusion of control. Jesus makes an offer and the leaders refuse. They have so much at stake in the past. They're not able to relinquish control, to see that the present is open. They're not able to change their minds. They're going to be loved anyway, but it is going to be, oh, so much harder to accept that love that will not let them go. In the face of our temptation to tether ourselves to the past, I find the writing of Sister Joan Chittister to be so helpful. She writes about where we find God today. God is right where we do not want God to be. God is in the newness of our lives. The God of the past is past now. There is only one way out, and that is forward. Then it is to the God of newness that we must go if we are really to be spiritual people. It's remarkable how those who are down and out grab hold of Jesus' promise of newness. Tax collectors and prostitutes reach out for Jesus' promise with both hands. God makes the same promise of newness to us. No matter what we have done, no matter what may have been done to us, the present is still open. The hurt we have experienced, the hurt we may have given, is in the past. Those hurts do not have to determine or dominate the present moment. They don't have to control us, and we certainly can't control them. We don't have to drag our past around on our backs the way a snail does its shell. In God, we are more than the sum total of all that has happened to us. Our present and our future are open. It is a vulnerable thing to be present in the now. But what better time when we're all shaky anyway and in such a state of flux, when we're all already experiencing uncertainty and fear? Ultimately, our parable focuses on God, the owner of the vineyard, the author of our lives, God who continually invites us into renewed relationship. God does not count our past against us. God refuses to be defined by what we do or by what has been done to us. God sees us always and only as beloved. I invite you to consider an element of your past, something you have done or something that has been done to you that you still regret or resent. God invites you to set that down, to let that go, to leave it behind. You can't control it. It doesn't control you. You no longer need to give this past thing authority over your life. This very real regret, this still stinging hurt, this long-held resentment. God invites you to step into the present moment without that burden on your back. During the music that follows the sermon, I invite you to offer this thing to God. Give it to the one who believes you are worthy of love, who calls you beloved, who invites you to put your burden down and to step into this present moment, relieved of its weight. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Great Spirit, creator of the universe, source of all that has ever been and ever will be, gather us together as your people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. When we can't touch with our hands, help us to reach out with our hearts. This morning, our prayers cover the globe. We pray for partners in Peru and the Congo and on the border. We pray for relatives, friends, strangers, reminded that all people are your people. All around the world and close to home, we pray for safety, for health, for wholeness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray that you would call us to service. As we are able, may we be your hands and feet and voice in the world, advocating for justice. May we feed the hungry, give drink to the thirsty, clothe the naked, and house those without homes. May we walk with those who feel they are alone, and may we do all that we can to heal and mend. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, help us so that we might help each other. So when we aren't sure, God, help us be calm. When information comes from all sides, correct and not, help us to discern. When fear makes it hard to breathe, and anxiety seems to be the order of the day, slow us down, Lord. Help us to breathe in your spirit. In the love of the Creator, in the name of the Healer, and the life of the Holy Spirit that is in all and with all, we pray these things. And now let us say together the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I thank you for all the ways in which you share your gifts with the world and with the church. May the gifts we offer today help to create God's kingdom, a kingdom that welcomes all, that invites all to serve. Amen.
Spirit born boys, the sound of one who made.
thank you for worshiping with us this day. As you head out into this week, remember, God is bigger than this pandemic. God's love is deeper than the challenges we are facing. God's grace is greater than all that we are facing. God is bigger than this pandemic. Now, may the blessing of God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, rest upon you and remain with you this day and forevermore. Amen.